and also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
As Jesus journeyed, he had to go through Samaria along the way. Eventually, he came to the Samaritan village of Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired from the long walk, sat wearily beside the well. It was about noontime. Soon a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Please give me a drink." He was alone at that time because the disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink?" Jesus replied, "If you only knew the gift God has for you and who you are speaking to, you would ask, and I would give you living water." "But sir, you don't have a rope or a water jar," she said, "and this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his children and his animals enjoyed?" Jesus replied, "Anyone who drinks this water will soon thirst again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." "Please, sir," the woman said, "give me this water. Then I'll never be thirsty again, and I will not have to come here to get water." "Go and get your husband," Jesus told her. "I don't have a husband," the woman replied. Jesus said, "You are right. You do not have a husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you are not even married to the man you are living with now. You certainly spoke the truth." "Sir," the woman said, "I perceive that you must be a prophet. So tell me, why is it that you Jews insist that Jerusalem is the only place of worship, while we Samaritans claim it is here at Mount Gerizim, where our ancestors worshiped?" Jesus replied, "Believe me, dear woman, the time is coming when it will no longer matter whether you worship the Father on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship, while we Jews know all about him, for salvation comes through the Jews. But the time is coming, indeed it is here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him this way. For God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus told her, "I am the Messiah." Just then his disciples came back. They were shocked to find him there talking to a woman, but none of them had the nerve to ask, "What do you want with her?" or "Why are you talking to her?" The woman left her water jar beside the well and ran back to the village, telling everyone, "Come and see a man who has told me everything I ever did. Could he possibly be the Messiah?" So the people came streaming from the village to see him. Many Samaritans from the village believed in Jesus because the woman had said, "He told me everything I ever did." When they came out to see him, they begged him to stay in their village. So he stayed for 2 days, long enough for many more to hear his message and believe. Then they said to the woman, "Now we believe, not just because of what you told us, but because we have heard him ourselves. Now you know Now we know indeed that He is the Savior of the world. My sisters and brothers, the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
And they have no water, and they are very thirsty. Have you ever been thirsty? Have you ever felt such a dryness of mouth and your throat seems so parched and you just can't wait to drink any kind of liquid libation you can find? This happened to me with my oldest son one year when we took the mile hike from the crest of the crater that has Crater Lake in Oregon. I don't know how many people have seen Crater Lake in Oregon. And you can hike down the side, which is very steep, to the waters below. And this is what we did. And that was fine and good because it was all downhill. But then we had to go up the mountain that we had just come down. And going up that trail, and the sun was hot and warm. It was in the summer. And as we were going up this trail, we were thirsty, and I didn't think to bring any bottles of water. And I knew what thirst was, because not only was I experiencing it, but the whole mile up, my son, who was about 14 at the time, kept complaining, "I'm thirsty, I'm thirsty, please get me something to drink." And he was rather cross about it, that I did not bring any water. So I have a little bit of an idea what Moses was experiencing when the people were complaining and demanding to have water and challenging the Moses the prophet that he really had bad motives to begin with. You just brought us out here to die in the desert when we could be drinking the waters of the Nile River. Why'd you even bother with this? And so Moses says, keep quiet. Isn't that a nice translation? I doubt if he was saying, "Oh, will you please be quiet?"
Yeah.
No, he said, "Shut up." Went to the Lord and complained to the Lord. And the Lord said to Moses, "Take your staff in hand and go out ahead of the people of Israel and then strike a rock." Moses did as the Lord had told him. And then all of a sudden, a miracle occurred. Out of this rock in the middle of the desert, gushed forth all of this fresh water. And the spring that was let loose there was called Massah. You think that would be a nice name for a miracle, right? Massah means to complain. And Meribah, you think that would be a nice word? You know, something like God provides. No. Meribah means to argue. And so that place became known, not for the water that gushed forth, but became known because at this point in their history, Israel was complaining and arguing with God's prophet. And the moral of the story, never argue with a prophet. Well, I do. But nonetheless, that is the story. Now, Christians have try to understand this particular story. You know that the children of Israel will wander in the desert aimlessly for the next 40 years, which means for a very, very long time. And this story is about thirsting. It is about hunger. And in the spiritual life, we can't speak directly of our religious or spiritual experiences, because a religious experience, and many of you have had religious experience, and in the spiritual life, many of you experienced your own spirituality, there is no language to describe the reality. There is nothing that I can say to describe to you the religious experience that I am having. So the only meaningful way that I can try to express something that is essentially ineffable, inexpressible, is to speak of it by way of analogy. And so the story of the children of Israel in the desert wandering around is a story that we use as an analogy of the spiritual life that each individual has. It is as if in our inner life, in the inner recesses of our soul, we too are wandering in the wilderness. And we have a spiritual experience that comes and goes. We cannot describe it exactly. It is a miracle for us, but it's difficult to describe. And yet, we continue to wander in this life which is like wandering in the desert as we look for the promised land. That place of bliss and perfection, leaving all suffering and hardship behind. And so you can see, readily see how that is a good story that expresses this by way of analogy. So we can look at the ancient stories of the Bible and ask, how is this analogous to my experience as a modern person living at the dawn of the 21st century? That is a good question to ask. I have this here, a Bible that belonged to my mother, and I want to read to you a verse that speaks to the gospel that we have heard today, the woman at the well, in which Jesus talks about living water. And this is a very old translation. It's in the Old English, and I'm going to read it to you that way so you remember how the Bible used to sound when you were young. Jesus says this, and this is not in the same story as the woman at the well, but this verse, this saying of Jesus, comes three chapters later. But it gives us an insight on what Jesus was trying to say to the woman at the well, what Jesus is trying to say to you and me at this very moment. Jesus says this, "He that believeth in me, as the scripture hath said, out of his innermost being shall flow rivers of living water." Now, Jesus, after making that statement, in the course of the narrative, the narrator now gives a parenthetical explanation as to what Jesus meant. I want you to catch this. "But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost," don't you love that word? Remember the Holy Ghost? "The Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified." There was a time in which the Spirit had not yet been given, for the Lord had not been glorified. The point of what I'm reading here is that the narrator, the evangelist, is telling you that when Jesus uses the expression living water, he is speaking by way of analogy. He is actually speaking of the Holy Spirit, and the experience of the Holy Spirit is beyond our ability to comprehend and to be able to express in ordinary language. So we must speak of it by way of analogy. In the responsorial song, a song that was written based upon this story of the children of Israel in Massah and Meribah, has this refrain. We sang it this morning. "If today you hear his voice, harden not your heart. If today you hear his voice, harden not your heart." The interesting thing about the divine as understood by Jews and Christians, and Muslims as well, our understanding, and as we conceive of the divine, we believe in a God who speaks. A God who has a voice and desires to communicate with his beloved humanity, which we are. And in fact, God is talking all the time in many ways. He speaks through the prophets. He speaks through the writings of the biblical writers. He speaks through the church. He speaks to us in many ways through people, even though they don't realize that they're speaking the words of God to you. The most common way that God speaks to you is through your own inner self. In your conscience, God is talking to you. But most of the time, we are oblivious of that reality. We think that God is silent and far removed from our experience. And when we hear his voice, not really being sure where that voice comes from or if it does, or if we do know where it comes from, we have a tendency as human beings to resist what God is saying to us. We harden our hearts to the message that God wishes to communicate to us. In this very moment, as you're in this sacred place, celebrating this holy liturgy, in a place that transcends space and time, in a moment that we call Kairos moment, God is now, at this very moment, speaking to you within the depths of your heart. And the message is, if today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. God wants to give you the gift of living water. In fact, Jesus, the Messiah, his mission is to bestow and to give to you the gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is the great giver of the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist said of him, he is the one who will come and baptize you in the Holy Spirit. So Jesus is the one who eagerly desires to impart living water, the Holy Spirit, which in the end is the only thing that really satisfies your deepest heart's desire. Because within you at this moment, within all of us, and throughout all of our lives, we experience thirst and hunger. Most of the desires we experience, we can easily satisfy. If I'm hungry, I just wander downstairs to the kitchen and I make myself a sandwich. If I am thirsty, I go and find some kind of liquid libation to be able to satisfy that thirst. This is true about all of the things in life. We are creatures motivated by desire. We are driven by our hunger and by our thirst for something. And we usually find temporary satisfaction. We are able to satiate those immediate needs. And yet, when I reflect upon my inner life, I become aware that there is a deep longing in my heart, a deep desire for something, a deep thirst, an ache within my heart. And I try to satisfy it with different activities, but they only last for a moment, and then I thirst again, and I am hungered. And so Jesus now speaks to us today through the story of the woman at the well. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. It was a hot day. It was about noon, and the Middle Eastern sun was blazing down upon the people of Samaria. And a woman of a village in Samaria was coming out in the heat of the day. It was about 12 noon, the writer tells us. He sets the stage with great detail. She is approaching by herself the ancient well of their ancestor Jacob to participate in that daily task that was assigned to women in their domestic duties to go and fetch water for the family. But there's something terribly wrong with this picture that the evangelist gives us in this story. For this woman is walking alone. That's unheard of for a woman to go out apart from the protection of the village by herself to the well. There's something else wrong with this picture, because the custom would have been, as it had been for generations, that before the sun would rise in the morning, all of the women of the village would gather in the village square without their children and without their husbands. This was a great opportunity, because as they would gather there, the women would talk to each other and have conversation. I don't know what they were talking about, but perhaps our sisters here, I noticed they like to talk to each other. So they probably had many things to talk about when they gathered every morning. They did so except on the Sabbath. One day a week, on Saturday, they would not do this. But then all the other 6 days, they would gather in the morning, and they would share in the latest gossip in the town, and go on and on telling stories. And so this was a social event for them. And then they would go as a group out to the well. Why? Because there were protection in numbers. Why else? Because it was the cool part of the day. The sun was rising, and they were fetching a jar of water, which they would take home and would supply the needs of the family home for the rest of the day. Well, this is strange. This woman is not with the other women. It's in the hottest part of the day when it's least likely you'll meet anyone at the well. She did this because we learn later on in the story that this woman wasn't like the other women of her village. She was marginalized. She was excluded from the life of the community because this woman was a woman who was indeed a failure in the stuff of life. This woman was judged and perhaps was the object of much of the gossip shared by the other women. She was not welcome. This woman carried upon her back a great burden, and it was the burden of shame. And so to avoid confronting everyone, she came in secret to the well to be unobserved. For we are told that she had multiple husbands. She had been married 5 times. And the man she's now living with is not even her husband. Oh, what scandal followed this woman. Oh, what shame she bore so heavily upon her heart. And this day she comes out and she looks up from a distance and she sees that there is a lonely stranger sitting by the well. It was Jesus. His disciples had went to buy groceries and he stayed behind at the well. This made the woman very nervous. He was a man. He was a stranger. And as she drew closer, she saw the distinctive talit that he would have worn. And she recognized that he was a Jew. And the Jews hated the Samaritans. And the Samaritans hated the Jews. So not only was he a stranger, but he was a stranger that was regarded with great hostility. So what does the woman do? Does she flee and go back to the village? No. She proceeds about her task. Ignoring the fact that Jesus is there, she averts her eyes. He is a stranger, and to her, she acted as though he was invisible. You can imagine the uncomfortable silence as she was lowering her jar with the long rope into the deep waters of the well of Jacob, her ancestor. And then Jesus has the audacity to break the silence. Now, I want you to be aware that this is highly unusual. There's all kinds of social taboos in how a man and a woman would interact in public. It was forbidden that a man would ever address a woman he did not know in public. It was forbidden. And so this woman is horrified and shocked that this stranger would speak to her. And Jesus speaks to her with a simple request. Give me something to drink. How often God comes to us with a very simple request. And the woman, shocked at this breaking of a long-held taboo, shocked, she says, why are you, a man and a Jew, speaking to me, a Samaritan? And then Jesus engages her in a divine conversation. It is a picture of the conversation between divinity and humanity. God is speaking. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. The woman didn't realize that divinity was now speaking to her. And so Jesus says, if you only knew, you only knew who was talking to you, then he would give you, you could ask, and he would give you living water. Living water. And a water that will so satisfy you, you will never be thirsty ever again. The woman took him literally. She says, yeah, right. Give me some of this water so I don't have to come out here every day and have this chore of fetching water for my family. But Jesus wasn't speaking of literal water. And so as she and she, the Lord have this conversation, she says, well, give me this living water.
And Jesus says to her, go and get your husband. And the woman replies, I have no husband. See how guarded she was? I have no husband. And Jesus then confronts her. He speaks to her deepest part of her pain and hurt. And he says, you have spoken truly. For in fact, you've had five husbands. And the man you're living with now is not even your husband. You have spoken truthfully. The woman is stunned. And then she follows up with, sir, I perceive you're a prophet. Well, yeah. And the woman, at the same time, is so guarded and so defensive, she changes the subject. How does she change the subject? It's something we all do. She asks a theological question. A question that is not just, I just wanted to know this detail, but the most controversial question that exists between Jews and Samaritans. The question which separates these two very similar people who speak the same language and worship the same God, and yet they hate each other over a theological point. She says, my ancestors, the Samaritans, we say that God should be worshipped on this mountain. You Jews say that we should worship God in Jerusalem. You see what she is doing? She's dodging. She would rather talk about a complicated theological question that ultimately is unanswerable than to talk about or with a man who knew everything about her. And so Jesus, being a Jew, said, well, you know, in that particular issue, the Jews are right. Salvation's of the Jews. You should be worshiping in Jerusalem. But that day is passing away. There's a new day coming. God the Father is looking for those who will worship Him in spirit and truth. And you can be anywhere and worship God in spirit and truth. It matters not what mountain you're on or what shrine you visit or what church you go to. God is looking for those who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. Integrity and the spirit are what is important to God, not religious dogmatism and rules and regulations of where and when you ought to go and worship God. Jesus' gospel is a gospel of liberty. And so the woman is amazed. She says, we're waiting for the Messiah. And Jesus says, I am He. She now having this realization, leaves her jar and rope behind and runs to the village. The very village that spurned her and marginalized her, and she became the apostle to the Samaritans. She proclaimed the gospel of Jesus. Come and see and meet Jesus, a man who's told me everything I have ever done. And they came out, the whole population of the village, to meet Jesus. And that whole crowd, that whole community, was dramatically transformed because they experienced the presence of Christ and received this gift of living water. Notice in the story, when Jesus said, I am offering you living water, and when the woman came out that the woman had been married five times, Jesus didn't say, I'll give you living water, except I want you to get an annulment for all those marriages. Those are man's rules. You see, the church has become very good about building a wall around this table. Around this table, so only a select few can come here to receive the life of Jesus. But that's not the attitude of our Lord. Our Lord said, the Son of Man has not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. It is an invitation. It is a free gift. And it is the desire of Jesus, who is the giver of the Holy Ghost, the giver of the Holy Spirit, to give you living water that would spring up within you, and that it would inundate your heart and your life, and would overflow and affect your body, your facial expression, and that will overflow to fill and touch the lives of those around you. Because, my brothers and sisters, we thirst, we ache, we hunger, because we need Him and the life that He wishes to impart to us even now. If today you hear His voice, harden not your hearts.